Till death do we know who's who in a celebrity's love life. From Farrah Fawcett's college sweetie to John Lennon's pre-Yoko Ono relationship, these celebs' affairs didn't stay hidden in the casket. With Farrah Fawcett's iconic golden blowout, million-watt smile, and effortless retro glam, she presided over the 1970s as America's beloved small-screen sweetheart. Her own heart, though, was commanded by a number of suitors, many known, some unknown.
Like they say, it's nice to have a man around the house.
Actor Ryan O'Neal stood out in public as her most well-recognized partner, despite having an on-again, off-again connection from the time her career peaked until the last decade of her life. After Fawcett's death in 2009, an unfamiliar name came to the forefront surrounded by claims that he was romantically involved with Fawcett during her final years. Greg Lott identified himself as Fawcett's college boyfriend, telling ABC News that they were together at the University of Texas and had reconnected in 1998. By then, Fawcett had made her way out of several consecutive relationships, including that with O'Neal. Lott revealed more about their connection, sharing, "Farrah Fawcett and I reunited, in a relationship, a loving, consensual, one-on-one relationship." He claimed that they remained exclusive and together until the Charlie's Angels star died. Lott and O'Neal apparently didn't get along during Fawcett's lifetime and even after. One of two legendary paintings Andy Warhol had done of Fawcett was carried off by O'Neal, despite the actor's living trust stating that all her artwork be forwarded to her alma mater. Lott notified the university and was aggressively fighting for the painting's return, according to CNN. A verdict in 2013 permitted O'Neal to keep the painting. The coming together of two stars as famous as Whitney Houston and Michael Jackson would have been quite something. While the artists never teamed up for a duet that would have doubtless reached chart-topping successes, Houston and Jackson did quietly indulge in a romance behind the scenes during the 1990s. For two of America's biggest acts to cross paths at the time was only inevitable. What wasn't common knowledge was that they shared something more than friendship. The supposed affair came to light after Houston's death in 2012 and after Jackson's death in 2009, when the latter's bodyguard approached the press with some unheard-of celebrity gossip. As Matt Fidesz explained to The Sun, Whitney practically moved into Michael's ranch and they had a fling like any other young couple.
We just sat together and the chemistry, it started working, you know.
Apparently, Fidesz further claimed that the Thriller hitmaker was even keen on marrying Houston as much as she felt the same. Close to both singers, producer David Guest revealed that Houston and Jackson reciprocated a desire to be married, but Jackson was too shy to pop the question, per the Indian Express. The moment she was unveiled in her Princess Leia fineries, Carrie Fisher became a fantasy of millions. Among them were many contemporaries in her own artistic league who fancied her as well. One such heavy hitter was rock legend Freddie Mercury.
This is a silly thing to talk about.
Is it really? That's funny because you've written a whole book about it.
If you're racking your brains to fish out a picture of Fisher and Mercury in a romantic embrace, don't strain your memory. Their affair was a surprise revelation made after Fisher's death in 2016 by way of a biography, Carrie Fisher and Debbie Reynolds, Princess Leia and Unsinkable Tammy in Hell. Fisher was introduced to him through her mother, Debbie Reynolds, who took her teen daughter to a star-studded party hosted by Mick Jagger in the 1970s, the book claimed. It was there that Mercury struck up a friendship with Fisher, though the Star Wars actor was initially hesitant about engaging with the Queen vocalist, who was in a long-term relationship with Mary Austin. She was soon enamored of the stage icon. The book gets into scandalous detail, even going on to claim that Fisher explored an affair with another famous queer icon she met at Jagger's party, David Bowie. Though Fisher never addressed these supposed liaisons during her lifetime, she did leave fans with a long-hidden and long-hoped-for secret. She and Harrison Ford were an item, telling People magazine, "It was Han and Leia during the week and Carrie and Harrison during the weekend." Amy Winehouse's magnificent presence in the world of music was highlighted as extensively as the goings-on in her private sphere. A popular soul and jazz figure until her death in 2011, with a legacy that endures even after, Winehouse was involved in a number of tumultuous relationships during her lifetime that were well-publicized, except one that apparently no one knew about.
And I was like, no, I've got a boyfriend.
Libertines frontman and known friend of Winehouse, Pete Doherty, came forward a year after her death with a dramatic revelation about their supposed romantic relationship, telling the Daily Mail, "Amy and I were lovers. I loved her then, and well, I still do today." Around the period that Doherty was hanging out with her, Winehouse was involved with Blake Fielder Civil in a famously tempestuous marriage with drug issues and jail time. Particularly memorable footage from the noughties hazily harks back to the time Winehouse, Doherty, and a few mice made a video titled Wine Mouse Together, discouraging a then-imprisoned Fielder Civil from divorcing Winehouse. Doherty warned, "If you divorce her, you'll have me to deal with." Rolling Stone magazine, acknowledging the infamous clip, asked Winehouse about Doherty in 2008. "She just called them good friends and left it at that." Doherty claimed that though Winehouse became unkind to him toward the end of their relationship, the two remained in touch until the final year of her life. Of all the salons in all the towns in the world, he walked into hers. Well, kinda. Verita Thompson worked as a hairdresser in and around Hollywood during the early 1940s, when her paths first crossed with one of cinema's most formidable legends, Humphrey Bogart.
"I'm not one of your modern husbands, chin up, stiff upper lip, and all that sort of stuff."
Casablanca was yet to release when Bogart, who had already secured his place as an American noir icon, locked eyes with Thompson at a party. He was then on his third notoriously volatile marriage to actor Mayo Matheux. Thompson was a married woman too, but sparks flew. Thompson shared with the press 4 decades after Bogart's death in 1957 that, "Bogey didn't like to dance, but honey, we danced the night away. And from that day on, we were lovers." Thompson revealed the affair in a tell-all book, Bogey and Me, A Love Story, in 1982, saying that Bogart always thought they'd make a perfect couple because they were so alike. Bogart and Thompson's association stretched until 1955, going steady even in the backdrop of Bogart's celebrated high-profile marriage to Lauren Bacall. Given the tightly wound industry norms at the time, Bogart and Thompson's secret love didn't make front-page headlines, but wasn't the best news for the iconic Bogart-Bacall union. Thompson was, in her own words, Bacall's worst nightmare. She died in 2008, having become an inseparable part of Bogart's legacy. In examining his immeasurable contribution to music and culture, history often glosses over the fact that John Lennon was a rather notorious adulterer. One of the women he is alleged to have been secretly involved with was the iconic pop singer Alma Cogan. In a startling revelation made nearly half a century after Cogan's death in 1966, her sister, Sandra Caron, confirmed her clandestine affair with one of the most revered songwriters in history. The Cogan-Lennon pairing was only spoken about in whispers at the time, but it was something no one admitted because John was married to Cynthia Lennon then, Caron told Evening Standard. Cogan reportedly hung out with all of the Fab Four, but her sexual chemistry with the smart Beatle was intense. So much so that even Cynthia couldn't help but notice how outrageously she flirted with him.
"When I really got down to it, and I got down to it."
Years after Lennon's death, she admitted she was aware of the spark between her ex-husband and Cogan. As the Daily Mail quoted her saying, "Now that I think about it, with all the emotion gone out of it, I can see the attraction." As goes Cynthia's narrative, Lennon was heartbroken after Cogan's death from cancer and found respite in Yoko Ono. In fact, she thought that Lennon's pairing with Cogan was the real deal. It was Lennon's extramarital involvement with the latter that apparently sealed the divorce deal for Cynthia in 1968. What defense do mortals like ourselves have against the charms of Cary Grant, when even a beauty queen like Sophia Loren couldn't resist? In a secret divulged almost 3 decades after Grant's death, Loren harked back to the 1950s, when she had a whirlwind romance with her famous co-star from The Pride and the Passion.
"I was not in love with Cary. How can you not be in love with Cary Grant?"
The film was a Hollywood milestone for Loren, who had so far only enamored audiences on her Italian home base and was debuting opposite one of America's biggest stars. As Loren recalls her first encounter with Grant to the Daily Mail, she said, "He looked as though he'd just stepped down from the screen, a dream come true." Grant, 30 years her senior, soon asked her out to dinner. At the time, Loren was on the cusp of marrying her partner, the Italian film producer Carlo Ponti. Grant himself was on his third marriage to Betsy Drake, but his onset romance with Loren was so fiery that he was dreaming of a life together. Grant wrote to Loren in a letter made public in her memoir, writing, "If you think and pray with me for the same thing and purpose, all will be right and life will be good." Curtains dropped on their passion-charged fantasies when Ponti's lawyers arranged his marriage to Loren by proxy in 1957. Loren later told the Sydney Morning Herald that not long before he died, Grant called her one last time to say goodbye. Patrick Swayze was married to the love of his life, Lisa Niemi, for 34 years. Childhood sweethearts, the two met during their teens and were together until the Dirty Dancing star's tragic death in 2009. Though Niemi is part of Swayze's enduring legacy as his longest partner, a second woman came forward claiming her significance in his life. Actor Kirstie Alley believed she had shared a profound emotional connection with the late dancer around the time the two co-starred in the 1985 television miniseries North and South. During a 2012 appearance on Entertainment Tonight, she revealed that she and Swayze fell in love despite both of them being married to other people at the time. She admitted, "I think what we did was worse because I think when you fall in love with someone when you're married, you jeopardize your own marriage and their marriage."
We aren't the kind of romantic people that sit around and say, "Oh, darling, I just know this forever."
According to a source quoted by Radar Online, Alley had strong feelings for Swayze. She apparently thought he was the most handsome, sexy, kind person she met. Every time she went on set, she fell more in love. Long after Swayze's death, she consistently watched the miniseries they had shot together. Best known for her television work in sitcoms Cheers and Veronica's Closet, Alley died in 2022, also from cancer, like Swayze. January 22, 2008 was a tragic day in Hollywood. Actor extraordinaire Heath Ledger was found dead of an accidental drug overdose in New York City. It was a sudden, seismic shock that rattled fans across the world, and also brought forth some unheard of details about Ledger's life. His long-term relationship with actor Michelle Williams, with whom he also shared a daughter, had come to an end only a few months before he died. After their breakup, the status of Ledger's romantic life was in the shadows, until it wasn't.
You're with your girlfriend or your friends or your family, and they're spying in on you, it actually feels like you're getting a slap across the face.
In a bombshell report after Ledger's death, Radar Online claimed that the Brokeback Mountain star was involved with Lindsay Lohan during his final days. Sourcing back to an alleged phone call between Lohan's parents, the outlet quoted her mother saying that Ledger and Lohan were very close, and that his death shook her to the core. Lohan's mother apparently also expressed fear for the Mean Girls star's life, saying, "When Lindsay Lohan's drunk or takes an Adderall with it, she will do something like Heath Ledger did in a second without thinking." Meanwhile, conflicting reports suggest that Ledger's endmost romance was with his good friend Mary-Kate Olsen, with a source telling People magazine, "They were hooking up, but neither were particularly interested in making it exclusive." It is well publicized that the masseuse who found Ledger dead in his apartment immediately dialed Olsen. It's impossible to flashback to Diamonds Are Forever without conjuring up the image of a stunning enchantress introducing herself as Plenty O'Toole to James Bond at a casino. Lana Wood, the beauty in question, was more than just an on-screen Bond girl flanking Sean Connery.
"You don't bring in stunt people for the love scenes is what I'm trying to talk about."
No.
In a revelation made a year after Connery's death in 2020, Wood revealed that the pair had taken their sizzling chemistry off camera for a brief fling around the time they filmed their 1971 spy thriller. It was likely a passionate affair, since Wood recalled for Fox News that kissing wasn't way up there on the list of events that took place during their liaison. Even so, Express quoted her saying that with the knowledge of her covert romance with Connery, acting out intimate scenes with him was especially tough, admitting, "I think anyone would be hard-pushed to resist Sean." Despite it all, the award-winning Connery didn't let matters of the heart overshadow his work, with Wood recalling his efficiency on set. Unfortunately, it wasn't a relationship built to last. Wood alleged that while Connery initiated the affair, it was she who called it off. She was dating music composer Leslie Bricus at the time, and, prizing her connection with him, thought it best to end things with Connery.